Hi everyone, welcome back to the IT and Psychology YouTube channel. Today we are going to be continuing with our chapter number 4 of Psychology, Cognitive Processes. In the first lecture we had learned about attention and perception and the introductory part of cognitive processes. Today we are going to be continuing with our unit 4.4, that is thinking. So here we have been given with an activity 6. So read the imaginary situation given below and try to understand the meaning of the thinking process. So just go through this and check your answers with your faculty. Here we continue to our unit 4.4.1, definition and core elements of thinking. Thinking is the mental activity that uses various cognitive elements and processes that involves manipulation of information, problem solving, reasoning, as well as decision making. If you analyze all the mental activities involved in thinking, you will find that thinking seems to be private and internal to ourselves. While thinking, we create a world within us and we run through various actions symbolically rather than in reality. The following are some of the core elements of thinking. So here we have been told that our thinking or our thought process is our own sandbox. Hum yahan pe kuch bhi soch sakte hain. So this is your own sandbox. You can alter your situations, you can alter anything in your thought process or thinking. So our first one given to us here is mental representation. So the first element says mental representation is the mental imagery of a thing that is not currently physically available to the senses. Mental representation is a coded internal sensation. For example, if you are asked to close your eyes and imagine a peacock in your mind, a visual image of a peacock comes in your mind with all its vivid colors, colorful plumage, shape, size, and even distinctive sound. This is a mental representation or an internal representation of a peacock. So this might change from person to person. The thought of a peacock, of a person who has seen a peacock and a person who has not seen a peacock, would be very different. So then we have our second core element, that is concept. Concept is an internal representation which the brain uses to denote a certain classes of things in the world. The concepts involve extraction of some idea on the basis of similarities and differences among many sensations. For example, a child forms a mental representation of a cow. Thereafter, he starts deriving some idea about what a cow means. It is a four-legged animal with head, body, tail, horns, etc. He is thus forming a concept of a cow. So as given above, a peacock, only the word would not explain itself. So the concept will help us imagine or have a mental representation of how a peacock looks or what are the features of a peacock, colorful feathers, legs, the beak, etc. etc. Concepts form the basis for all the cognitive processes. Various concepts act as a building block by connecting with each other to form more complex concepts like schema. Then we have here the third core element is schema. A schema is an internal representation that organizes knowledge about related concepts and relationships among them. Schemata influence most of the cognitive processes. For example, when a child visits a zoo, the concepts of animals, home, cage, display, public, etc. gets activated simultaneously and a connection is established between them. This leads to formation of a schema of a zoo. So it is important. So then we have our fourth core element, that is language. Language is a system of symbols. Mental representations, concepts, and schemata are all better represented by a language. For example, the word cat stands for actual cat. So the word cat is a symbol for a cat. Thinking by using language is a distinctive feature of human beings' thinking process. So here we have our unit 4.4.2, types of thinking. This has been removed from the syllabus for students appearing for boards in the year 2021. But I'm going to be discussing this for your juniors. as it is important. The first one here is problem solving. Problem solving refers to the process of finding solutions to problems encountered in life. It is one of the types of thinking. Problem solving includes the following steps. So here we have been given with four steps of problem solving. Generating alternative solutions. For every problem, there are various solutions, some effective while some may turn out to be ineffective. In the second step of problem solving, a person tries, In this step, a person needs to identify and define the problem correctly. If a person defines the problem incorrectly, he will never reach the solution. For example, when a baby is crying due to a stomachache, and if his or her mother wrongly interprets it as due to hunger, the problem remains unsolved. So this is a puzzle. So defining the problem is really important. Next we have here is generating alternative solutions. For every problem, there are various solutions. Some effective, while some may turn out to be ineffective. So here there might be an example of chess. In chess, if you make a right move, it might be effective in your future game, and it might lead you to checkmating the opponent and helping you win the game. Or else a blunder might cause your game to get spoiled and you to lose. So we'll continue to the explanation of generating alternative solutions. In this second step of problem solving, a person tries to search for all those possible actions that can solve a problem. For example, if a person is suffering from a severe headache, he or she may start thinking of taking rest, listening to music, meditating, taking medicines, etc. There are many solutions. So here, selecting a solution. In this third step of problem solving, out of many possible solutions, the person selects one of the bases of the reasoning applied. Reasoning ability of an individual helps him or her to solve problems more realistically. For example, if a person recalls the meditation helped him or her in reducing his or her headache last time, he or she will select the same solution for the problem in the current situation. So, from previous experience, an individual will try to use the same solution to help him or her in this problematic situation. You're implementing and following up to the solution. In the last step of problem solving, a person actually tries out a certain solution and evaluates the outcome on the basis of whether it has helped him or her to resolve the problem or not. If the problem is still unresolved, a person might have to go to one of the previous steps and carry out the problem solving procedure again. Then we have here, I'm sorry for the background noise, it's raining a lot lately. Just bear with me. Then we have our next type of thinking, that is the creative thinking. Creativity is characterized by the ability to perceive the world in new ways, to find hidden patterns, to make connections between seemingly unrelated phenomena, and to generate solutions. Scientists, musicians, poets, fashion designers, interior decorators, etc. always think in a creative way. Creative thinking seems to be following four sequential stages. So the four sequential stages given to us here are preparation, incubation, illumination, verification. So let's discuss these. The first one given to us here is preparation. It is the stage of formulating the problem and gathering information, materials, etc. for finding new solutions. Creative ideas do not come from a vacuum. Many tentative solutions are tried out and discarded. No progress seems to be made in this stage. So this is just our hit and trial method. For example, if a poet wants to write a song for a particular movie, he may start preparing for it by brainstorming, reading, gathering his own past experience or anything that can help him to move forward finding a new solution. So this is more like foundation building and checking if your future work does not match up with your previous work, so that you don't think you're copying yourself. Then we have the next method, that is incubation. After preparation, a person starts working on a problem but may not get the required solution. This initial failure leads to the stage of incubation. During this stage, the person is so frustrated that he or she thinks of giving up. The person then leaves the problem and focuses on other things which are unrelated to the problem. Incubation may help the person to work on the problem without consciously thinking about it. This period, though, appears to be non-fruitful, is followed by a period of sudden appearance of the solution. So then we have our example given to us. For example, a poet may start writing some lines for his new poem, but may feel that the lines written are inappropriate. He may write for 2 days straight, then may give up, and then may not write for weeks. During these weeks of incubation, he may follow his routine, like going to gym, eating, watching a movie, talking to friends, etc. So this is more of a chrysalis stage, getting ready for our next stage. So this is not much fruitful, but it is effective. So next we have here is the illumination element. Illumination. After incubation, suddenly, like a flash of light, the correct solution appears in front of the mind's eye and the person experiences a rush of excitement. All the bits and pieces of ideas which appeared to be unrelated earlier fall into place. The solution that appears is nearly next to perfect. A person experiences an emotional reaction of joy, knowing that he or she has found a new idea, a solution. Here the example is, for example, a poet will suddenly find the exact lines that he was searching for weeks together. This will be the aha moment for him. So this was our illumination. Then we have the verification stage. Verification. Following the euphoria of previous stage, the new solution still needs to be tested. In most cases, it requires only minor changes, but sometimes it may require a lifetime of study, testing and retesting. For example, a poet will write his new poem on a paper while read it again and again, will check whether any word line is still to be changed. So he or she will keep checking it or verify the validity of it. Then we have our next unit, that is 4.5, that is the learning part. 4.5.1 says meaning and definition of learning. You might think of learning in terms of what you need to do before an upcoming exam or acquiring new skill like dancing or cycling. But it is only a small segment of the vast learning process which encompasses all areas of life, including school learning, learning various skills, learning about places and people, and many more. So this was our introductory part of meaning and definition of learning. Then we have our activity 7. Read the following examples and identify the duration of change in behavior. So do part A and B and verify the answers with your faculty. With reference to the examples given in the above box, we can understand that any temporary change in the behavior is not considered as learning. Learning involves relatively permanent change in behavior. Learning may take place because of practice. Learning may take place because of experience. Thus, learning can be defined as a relatively permanent change in behavior that occurs due to experience or practice. Then we have our unit 4.5.2, processes of learning. This again has been included in the reduced syllabus of students appearing for boards in their 2021 due to the COVID-19 situation. So students do not need to learn this last part. This is only for your juniors. So I'll just do it quickly for them. Learning is a complex process. There are many processes of learning. Some of the processes of learning are as follows. There are 5 ways of learning. The first one is learning by classical conditioning. The second one is learning by operant conditioning. Third is learning by cognitive processes. fourth one is learning by assimilation and accommodation, and the fifth one is learning by observation. So we'll start with our first one, learning by classical conditioning. Learning by classical conditioning was explained for the first time by a Russian psychologist, Ivan Pavlov, in the year 1928, through his experiment on a dog. So just before we start this, I'll give you an overview of what he had done. So what he had done was, he inserted a tube surgically in the salivary gland of his dog. So every time he made the sound of the bell and he gave his dog food, just to see that if he salivated. So after a few days, even by the sound of the bell and no food given to the dog still salivated. So this is what classical conditioning is. It's like just disciplining his dog to when he would give his food, but the dog would think that his body was conditioned to having food every time he heard the bell sound. So let's just learn the theory part quickly. He inserted a tube surgically in the dog's salivary gland so that he could measure the amount of salivation. He then presented the sound of bell and food one after the other several times and measured how much the dog salivated. After several trials, the dog started salivating to the sound of the bell even when the food was not given. As I told previously, based on his findings, Pavlov gave a theory of learning called classical conditioning. In our daily life, we learn many things by classical conditioning. For example, when a small child is given an injection, he starts crying due to the pain. A small child slowly understands that whenever he visits the doctor, he is given an injection. When he understands the connection between doctor and injection, he immediately starts crying as soon as he is taken to the doctor. So this was classical conditioning. Here we have been given an activity based on classical conditioning. Please verify these answers with your faculty. Get an efficient answer or an efficient overview of this topic. Then we have learning by operant conditioning. Learning by an operant conditioning was explained by an American psychologist, Burgess Frederick Skinner. He performed an experiment in which a rat was put in a special box that contained a lever. If the rat pressed the lever, he was given food. Gradually, the rat learned to press the lever to get food. Here, the rat is learning to connect his behavior of pressing the lever with receiving the food. According to Skinner, certain behaviors may be learned to gain positive consequences. Similarly, he also demonstrated that certain behaviors may be learned to avoid negative consequences. So, operant conditioning has positive consequences and negative consequences both. Here, again, we have been given an activity based on our operant conditioning. Please verify the answers with your faculty. Then we have a third type of learning, that is learning by cognitive processes. Just when Skinner and Pavlov were talking about connections and consequences of behavior, Edward Tolman demonstrated that though rats in his experiments were not given any food, they still learned about the different pathways in the maze. That means rats created maps in the mind just for the sake of it. His experiment demonstrated that learning may take place in the mind using mental processes that we call cognitive processes now. So this is an important part, learning by cognitive processes. This might be asked to your juniors. Then we have our fourth process of learning, that is learning by assimilation and accommodation. Jean Piaget explained that we learn many things by assimilation and accommodation. Jean Piaget is of the opinion that on the basis of the new experience or new information, we keep refining the existing concept that we have. For example, when a child deforms a concept of a cow, he or she extracts some general rule of characteristics to form a concept of a cow. But when he encounters a buffalo, he or she notes the differences between the cow and buffalo and forms a separate concept of a buffalo, thus increasing their thought habit. This process of forming and refining our concepts on the basis of the similarities and differences is called learning by assimilation and accommodation. The next process of learning is learning by observation. According to Bandura, we learn many things by observing someone's behavior and later reproducing it. Many of our skills like eating, walking, writing, etc. are learned by observing others. We observe and imitate not only the movements of the body, but also certain ways of thinking, evaluating, judging and decision making, etc. So here we have been given with a summary of the chapter. Please go through this to get an overview of this, the concepts taught in this chapter. The important concepts and the important psychologists have been named. So this was our chapter number 4. The exercise video will be coming up soon. Thank you for watching. You've been a lovely audience. Please like, share and subscribe. And if you have any doubts pertaining the topics taught in this video or the topics taught in previous videos, you can contact me on the group for doubts on Telegram by the link given in the description. And if you want to know how much syllabus has been removed, that 25% syllabus for our HSC board, or what questions have been removed from our syllabus for both psychology and IT, you can find the videos given in the description. And I've made videos on the first 3 chapters of psychology and 4 out of 6 chapters in IT. You'll find the links in the description that include the concepts explanation and discussion of the exercise solutions. And I'll be explaining the SOPs for IT soon. So stay tuned for that. And if you want any exclusive notes and if you want to support the channel, please follow me on Patreon via the link given in the description. Thanks for watching.